Aloha, or bonjour, as they say here atop Mont Blanc, on Chamonix in France, home of the 1924 Winter Olympics, and perhaps the most extreme place in the world for winter sports. Our story begins not so long ago in a little town in the French Alps called Chamonix. Nestled in a valley in the easternmost corner of France, sharing borders with Italy and Switzerland, Chamonix is the quintessential alpine village. The valley itself stretches about 14 miles from north to south and separates the Aiguille Rouge, or Red Peaks mountain range, from the Mont Blanc massif. Mont Blanc is Europe's tallest peak at just over 15,000 feet. Some of the most experienced mountain guides in the world take 25 of the world's best snowboarders up to the high mountains for the free ride of their lives at the first ever Rusty Crystal. Chamonix is known as the mountaineering capital of the world, with 7 separate ski areas, 49 different lifts, 9,000 feet of vertical snowboarding, and 30,000 acres of terrain to explore. Chamonix is a snowboarder's dream.
It's different. It's something totally different.
Chamonix, you always get the powder. There's always a place where there's fresh powder and stuff.
This is incredible. It's so huge. For me, in New Zealand, you only get like 4 lifts on each ski field, you know, and no gondolas. So for me, this is like times 100. So it's potential galore.
But it's like so impressive, big mountains. Like when you go up there and you see all those crevices and all those ice peaks, you're like, oh my God, I have to respect. You know, you're like, okay, if I do anything wrong, that mountain will eat me. I don't want to be mountain food.
Our Board Stories crew had come to Chamonix for the Rusty Crystal, a very different sort of snowboarding event.
It is special because we want to bring among the snowboard people the concept of respect the environment, respecting about the fact that if they want to get a good ride, they must fight for it. When you are surfing and you want to catch a wave, you really have to fight, to paddle out. You have to suffer. When most of the snowboarders, when they go to the mountains, they take a lift, they go on helicopters, it seemed a little bit easy, okay? And bringing the concept of the big mountain concept that snowboarder will have to climb on the top of the start, where they will have to get the ride, is a concept that they will have to suffer.
Now, you may know that snowboarding's roots are in surfing, but there are several major differences. In the pursuit of waves, surfers have to work for what they ride. From the paddle out to the duck dive to actually paddling into catching waves, surfers have to expend an awful lot of energy. All of these things tend to teach the surfer respect for the ocean and its power. It would appear that snowboarders have it pretty easy, riding lifts and enjoying the scenery until they reach the top of the hill, where they strap in and enjoy the downhill run. The organizers of the Rusty Crystal had something else in mind. They call it respecting the mountain and earning your gravity.
But we can do it with a little bit more respect for the mountain, and just by the way you're walking, and so you have to spend time to sweat a little bit. So, and you are not in the middle of all those metal lifts and stuff. You can really think where you are. You can really, okay, that's big, that's...
We'll continue with Chamonix when we return. We'll also snowboard one of the most unlikely spots on the planet. Take the lead or let me I'm Mike Latronic from one of the most extreme locations in the world. Check this out. The first part of the Rusty Crystal was held at La Grand Montée, sort of a warm-up for the team.
Ouch.
At 9,000 feet, oxygen is pretty scarce, but there's plenty of air.
Is this my bar lift ticket?
After lunch, or déjeuner if you prefer, our group set out on a hike across La Mer de Glace, the Sea of Ice, a massive glacier. The object for this afternoon was the Refuge d'Argentière, an alpine shelter for mountaineers, hikers, and obviously wayward snowboarders. Setting out across the glacier on snowshoes, the group was led by Jean-Franck Charlet, the mountain guide in Chamonix.
And what I like to do is to inform, you know, more and more the snowboarder that they have to know something about the mountain, something about safety in the mountains, avalanches and so on, crevasses, glacier and so on. So that's, I think, that's the idea of this event.
A hike across this glacier at 10 or 11,000 feet is a pretty major endeavor in and of itself. But without a guide like Jean-Franck, it would be impossible. The danger in boarding any backcountry region is that the hazards are unmarked. Cornices, avalanches, and snow bridges give way without warning. These glaciers in Chamonix are exponentially more unfriendly. In fact, most snow country terrain in Europe is dangerously unmarked. Even the most experienced mountain men get tired and sick with altitude. Jean-Franck was our security blanket in these hostile surroundings. Several hours later, an exhausted crew arrived at the refuge for a hot, salty meal and a cold bunk.
Yeah, we got work today, mate, walking up here. We got work.